ओम शांति। यस्टरडे आई वॉज डिस्कसिंग द प्रोसेस ऑफ ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन एंड आई सेड दैट इट स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम रियलाइजेशन। द डीपर आवर रियलाइजेशन एंड द मोर फर्म आवर डिटर्मिनेशन, द स्पीडियर, क्विकर एंड ईजियर इज आवर ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन। एंड I said there are certain factors after determination which help us. Some of them I called facilitatory, the others inhibitory. There are two ways of transforming. One is that you stop the negative thinking. The other is that you start the positive side. Now, when you take up the positive side of doing things, it is facilitatory. There are certain points in our consciousness. If we touch them, they become activated and they serve as fountainheads of energy. They open the floodgates to our process of transformation. Whatever transformation is taking place, you will find it is because one of those spots, one of those points has been touched by any one of the points of Baba's Murli. So I was taking some of those points, and one of them which I mentioned briefly was love. Baba has said in many Murlis that when you first came to this spiritual institution, this university, or to this knowledge, it was love which first of all attracted you. That established some kind of a rapport between you and Baba. You first came closer mentally. So that gave you some kind of a receptivity. Your mind was then prepared to accept the teachings of Baba, to start your process of transformation. And Baba dwelt at length on this in many Murlis, that if someone is not getting transformation, what is needed is to bring him closer, mentally to open up, so that he can accept it. His resistance is no more there. So this is what is required. Love is the lever. It is the tool of transformation, the greatest tool of transformation. You may give many discourses, but the transformation may not take place. But your one soft touch, your feather touch of love may touch the mind so much. It may open up the person for transformation. So this I was saying is very essential. And I would say, Baba in many Murlis mentions that if you become molded, when you mold yourself, you become gold. But before molding, you have to melt. And it is love which melts. First of all, you have to melt a person in the furnace of love. It's not furnace in that sense, but because melting, the process of melting requires some kind of heat. Therefore, I am saying this, some kind of warmth. That warmth of our behavior, our mental, spiritual warmth, will melt the person. And then, when that hard crust settled on the soul is broken, then the knowledge will pierce into the soul. Then transformation will take place. So first of all, in order to mold it into gold, you have first of all to melt it. And love is the thing which will do it. And Baba has been saying that love leads you to sacrifice. Even in worldly love, when someone loves a person, one is prepared to make every sacrifice, any sacrifice. You must have heard people saying, "My dear, my darling, I can bring even the moon for you, if you ask for it." Now how can this man who cannot cross a hurdle of 10 feet can bring the moon? But it is just a way of saying that one whom you love, you can do anything, good or damn thing, for the person. So when you love Baba, then you are prepared to make any sacrifice. We find from the transformation of our sisters and brothers, that when Baba loved them so much, when they were touched by Baba's love, without expecting anything in return, Baba is loving us. He wants to give. There is no question of his taking anything from us. And when our mind really realizes He loves us so much for our own benefit, for our goodness. No one ever has given us so much deep love, intense love, which Baba is giving us, Bab Dada is giving us. Then, when in that spirit of love, when Baba says, children, wouldn't you do this? You love me. Then if I ask you to give up this, wouldn't you give this up? We at that very moment say, yes, Baba, why not? We will give it up. When you say. So, this giving up of sex lust, anger, greed, all this process has been going on because Baba has given us love and He wants nothing in return. Baba says, I don't demand anything from you which is of value to you, but something which is valueless for you. Not only valueless, but something which is harmful to you. I ask you only to give up your thorns and get from me a cartload of flowers in turn. So it is the cheapest bargain, the best ever which we could make, which we ever could dream of. Therefore, when Baba says this with love, we say, certainly Baba will give this. So this thing is very essential. And when Baba says, you are on the throne of my heart, we say to Baba in response, Baba, you are on the throne of our heart. When Baba is on the throne of our heart, there cannot be two kings on the same throne. Either the Maya will be in our heart as it has been for centuries, for decades, for millennia, 2 millennia and more, or Baba can be there, either Rama or Ravana, not both of them. Ravana must be destroyed when Rama takes the throne. So when we surrender our throne to Baba, Baba, you are now the ruler of my throne of my heart. And naturally, we make the Maya leave that throne. It abdicates itself. So this is the process of transformation. You know perhaps the story of King Janak and Ashtavakra. King Janak was very much searching for higher spiritual experience. And in the first instance, he wanted self-control, control of mind. So it is said that he held a conference to which he invited great religious spiritual scholars. And he asked them, can any one of you in this court, in my presence, give me a method whereby I can control my mind? And that control of mind should take place within a very short span of time. And what was that short span of time? There were no clocks during that period. He said, suppose a person is riding a horseback. Now he puts his one foot in the strap and then he puts the other one across the back of the horse. Now within this much time, just putting the 2 feet in the strap and sitting on the back of the horse, within this much time, can any one of you give me the ability to control my mind? He was asking everyone. Just at that point of time, entered someone whose body had bents at 8 places. Therefore, his name was Ashtavakra. Ashtavakra means whose body has twists and bends at 8 places. So he looked very ugly. He could not stand straight on his legs, could not walk. He was walking like an animal and just almost dragging himself on the ground to reach King Janak and to take a place and to accept the challenge. Just at that point of time, everyone laughed because he was so ugly and his skin, his features were all twisted, many of them, at many places. So they laughed. Now he said, King Janak, I can accept your challenge. I will tell you the method whereby to control the mind and to transform yourself within the span of time which you have laid the condition for. And he also made a comment on the other religious scholars who were in that conference. He said, look, they are laughing. You ask them why they are laughing. They cannot give you that method. They are laughing because they see the twists and bends in my body. They are body conscious. They are cobblers. They are the sellers of skins. In our country, in our vernacular, they say, ye chamar hai. chamar. Chamar means anyone. If someone is selling skins, whenever he sees a cow or a calf or a camel, he sees the skin. He values it in terms of skin. If I take the skin of this animal when it is dead and sell it, how much it is worth? So he is not seeing the animal, he is seeing the skin in terms of that value. So they are seeing only my skin, my body. They are body conscious people. So how can they enable you to be the ruler, the controller of your mind? These are chamars, he said. You see, one of the lowest castes considered to be the untouchable people. He said they are utterly body conscious. So how come you have invited these people and do you think that they can give you what you are demanding? I can give you. Then he said, he had given the condition that if someone can enable him to control the mind, he would give him the whole kingdom. He said, O king, I don't want the whole kingdom. I just one thing from you. Because when you said you will give it, you are, give yourself and give your kingdom and serve the person who enables you to have control of mind, fulfill one condition. He said, what is that? I am prepared to do anything, give anything, but I am after a method which gives me self-control. He said, give me your mind. Can you give me your mind? You see, can you just give me your mind for 2 minutes? It was a difficult, very ticklish question. He said, after a brief pause, yes, I will give you my mind. Then he said, are you thinking at this moment? What are you thinking? The king confessed whatever thoughts were in his mind. He said, now you cannot think on your own because you have given your mind to me. Now you have to think what I say, what I ask you to think. Because your mind now no longer belongs to you. You are not the master of your mind in the sense it is not your belonging. It now belongs to me because you have given it to me. So now you have to think only the thoughts which I ask to think. It is my instrument, no longer yours. So what you have to think? Think, I am a soul. I am a soul. I am light. I am soul. I am eternal. I am immortal. Have only these thoughts. And when he thought, he asked him, what is your experience now? Oh yes, it is self-control. Now that was the way. Within that limited span of time, he was able to control. He gave him this method. So Baba says, you are Ashtavakra. You are, this body is deformed because it is the end of the Kalpa. And compare your present body to the one which you had in the golden age. So we cannot sit straight, we cannot see straight, we cannot walk straight, you see. So we have many bends and twists. And this is, we are Ashtavakra. It is said that Ashtavakra was the child of Shiva. It's a long story about his birth. So Baba says that he compares us to Ashtavakra. And to those who want the self-control, to King Janak, who become, want to become Videh, that is, without having the feeling of body, who want to withdraw from the body, to have a feeling of bodilessness. So Baba says, give this method to others. So when you give your mind to Baba, why you give? Because you love him. You say, Baba, I give my heart to you. Whenever many sisters and brothers from foreign countries send invitation, send greetings to Baba on various occasions, the shape is of heart. Baba, I love you. And here they bring all the gifts, the cake and everything, like the fine sign of heart, saying that we love you. It's a sign of love. So when you have given your mind to Baba, the symbolical meaning is that now your mind is no longer yours. So you cannot think as you used to, the negative thoughts, the bad thoughts, the evil thoughts. Now, since Maya has been dethroned and Baba has been enthroned, he has taken his place. So your thoughts cannot be the same. Otherwise you have not given your heart. You are only making a show of it, not really given it. So Baba very often asked, you really love me? Children, do you really love me? He said, yes, Baba. So then he says, then why you have these kinds of thoughts? Why you say, Baba, we forget you? If you really, you see, you shake your head from in 180 degree and then you say, yes, I love you. But still you love other people. There are so many images. After having given up the idol worship, there are so many idols in the temple of your mind. You are still worshipping. You are still idol worshippers. Baba says, have only me, my image. Then only you will be created in my image. So that is the way. The process of transformation starts with love. And when Baba says, beloved children, sweet children, and we say, Baba, sweet Baba, beloved Baba, you see. You may not even speak, you may only say, it means love. So when you love Baba as father, as mother, as teacher, as preceptor, that is why you celebrated the Valentine Day. What was it for? Because you said Baba is our beloved, we love Baba. So you celebrated Valentine Day. And Baba gave so fascinating, so precious murli on that day. What does it mean? How we should have love? Whatever the circumstances, any love story tells us that the lover crosses all the hurdles ultimately to meet the beloved. Any story, any poem shows this, that anyone who loves really is victorious because one has got that will, strong will to conquer all the obstacles in the way to attain the beloved. So Baba said that day when we celebrated that Valentine Day, I was here at that time, that then you cannot make any lame excuses that it was because of this reason, that reason or the other reason. Nothing can stand in your way. Your love will shine. And when Baba says, children, my sweet children, I will take you on my shoulders. I will take you on my eyelashes. I will take you across this whirl of the ocean of vices and sorrows. And how he says, what are his gestures when he says, look into his eyes, listen to his words carefully, and feel the vibrations which he gives at that time. He reassures us again and again, don't worry, whatever you might have done in your past lives, I take all the responsibility on me. Is there anyone who can accept our whole responsibility of our so many lives? When he assures us in such words, then our mind is overwhelmed with the feelings. Here is the one who really loves us. And we want to make sacrifice. Like the moth on the flame, we want to sacrifice ourselves. And then the transformation does not appear to us to be difficult. So love is the real thing. It is the real magic which can transform us. The rod of magic which Moses had to transform people. This is the rod actually. So therefore I was saying that Baba very often asks us, when we say we love Baba, love in all these relationships, friend, philosopher, guide, teacher, preceptor, mother, father, and all. Love in all these relationships. The more our relationship is intense, intimate, loveful with Baba, all these relationships, the multidimensional transformation, the all complete transformation then takes place without much efforts. And Baba says, Mahabbat, love is a good word, but Mahabbat has a special connotation. Mahabbat, when you have love, so that with the feeling of sacrifice, overwhelmed with love, your mind is overflowing with love. There is not even a point, a drop, you see, which can accommodate the drop of love for someone else. That overwhelming love, the cup of your love is overflowing with the love for Baba. When that much mahabbat is there, that love is there, then Baba says the transformation will really be very, 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 very easy. Then the other thing which touches us, touches our mind, which Baba makes use of for our transformation, the other lever of transformation, the other factor which brings transformation, the other point where there is the source of energy which spurts out when Baba touches it with certain points in murli, is sympathy. Just as we have love, it is natural in us. The only thing is, love is to be transformed, it is to be redirected, it is to be sublimated. When you do this process of sublimation, transformation follows. Similarly, the other sentiment in us is, which is natural to every human being, is of sympathy. You always have sympathy for one or the other. There is no human being who is like a stone, who hasn't got any sympathy for any being, any on any occasion, under any circumstances. Everyone does have a card of sympathy. That is to be stirred. Baba touches that card of sympathy in so many ways by giving so many points in murlis. For example, sometimes he says, children, Don't you listen to the wails and weepings, the cries of the bhaktas? They are crying, they are peaceless. You are the gods and goddesses who are worshipped in temples, and they are praying to you for peace, begging for it, with a begging bowl in their hand. Give us peace. O Devi, O Shakti, give us peace. Or anyone of other of images of yours, they go to temples, wake up the whole night, praying, crying, spending so much of time and energy. So don't you feel sympathy for them? Can you sleep? Children, can you really sleep? Sakar Baba used to say, I cannot sleep because their cries and wails come to my ears. I feel I am called upon to do something. So I cannot sleep. One of the sisters in our center in Shaktinagar, Sister Chakradari, who is now in Russia, she once came here to meet Bab Dada in Madhuban. That was way back in the 50s. And she met Baba in the morning to say good morning. Baba said, children, did you have good sleep? She said, yes, Baba. In order to please Baba, because one who is the host always feels concerned for the comfortable sleep of the guests. And since Baba had asked, there were others also with her, Baba asked, did you enjoy good sleep? She said, yes, Baba. Baba said, but could you sleep? How could you sleep? Children, how can you sleep? You see, she did not expect this kind of thing. You see, Baba said, you children, can you really sleep? So much people in the world, my children, are crying. Can a mother sleep? When she listened to the wails and weepings, the sound of weeping, the crying of the child, she cannot sleep. Even a small movement of the child in the bed would waken up. The mother feels concerned for the well-being of the child. She may be sitting in one room. The cry is coming from the third, fourth, or fifth room. She can recognize the cry of the child. This is my child. There may be another child crying, but this is not my child. This is the other lady's child. But this child is mine. She does not just put on the shoes or the socks. She just runs to the where the child is. Even when there is fire, she may like to save the child rather than herself. And you are the world mothers. And can't you sleep when your children are weeping? They are crying. And you can give them something only. You can give them peace only when you yourself are peaceful. And how can you be peaceful unless and until you are free from the negative thoughts? So first of all, you must free yourself from the negative thoughts, because you are called upon to share your peace with others. You are the one, the lucky ones, the fortunate ones, who are able to meet Bab Dada, to have his inheritance, to recognize him. When you get so much from him, are you selfish? Why don't you share it with others? And have you lost your sensibilities? Are your sensibilities dead? Can't you listen? Are you deaf? Can't you listen to those bhaktas who are crying and say, Devi, Shakti, Durga, Sheetala, Santoshi Ma, so on and so forth. Give me peace. Please give me peace. Real peace. Just even for a split second, give me real peace. So much disturbed they are, so that they want to commit suicide. And you are here eating tollies and sleeping. You see. It is because I don't mean to say that when you, from tomorrow morning when you go out of the class, you should not accept tolly, otherwise he will blame me, you see. Accept your tolly, that is your birthright. But have sympathy for those people who are crying for it. Because tolly will give you energy. You feel more peaceful when you get tolly. I know that. So you can share more peace after getting tolly, but if you like, you can share tolly also with them. Okay. So Baba says, you are spending much of the time and energy on yourself. You are not able to stand on your own legs. Always you say, Baba, we have this problem, that problem, or the other problem. So how will you serve others? You must be ready. In no time, don't spend much time on yourself, because you have to do much service. There are millions whom the message has even not yet reached. they do not know Baba has come. Baba says, they are all my children. And when a father has a festivity in his house, he invites all the children. It's a good occasion, a festivity in the house. All of you, please come. Come one, come all, welcome. And if he does not send invitation to any one of the children, they complain. They say, Father, perhaps you no longer love us. No, no, child, I love you. Then why did you not invite? I invited you, but perhaps the mail did not reach you. You see, but perhaps you sent late. You were late in loving us, you see. But in this case, the message has even not reached millions of people. So Baba says, it's not that I would be going and reaching all the people and giving the message. It's for you, children. So you must give the message. So how can you just do this unless and until you are moved? Your mind is moved. You have that kind of softness of mind, sensitivity. You feel concern for your brothers. That question was, am I the keeper of my brother? Yes, Baba says you are certainly the keeper of your brother. You must give the message to them. And that can be done only when sympathy is there. And when that cord of sympathy is activated, that is touched, then you feel that you must change yourself. It's no longer that you should waste time on yourself. Then there is another way of rousing sympathy in our mind. When I, for example, came first in the institution, one of the very first letters which I got from Baba, Baba said, child, would you not help Baba in the task of creating the golden aged world? I said, I am a small child, fit for nothing. I don't know anything at all. And he is almighty. And even if it is Brahma Baba who is writing this letter to me, he is the first among the human creation. And just see his humility. He is asking me to help him, to cooperate with him. It's an honor, it's a privilege, actually. But this one thing, by saying just this one sentence, writing this one sentence in his letter, he touched my cord of sympathy. Certainly, Baba. So I slept at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock after midnight. Because at that time we are only 4 or 5 brothers, dedicated brothers in this institution. Very little number of sisters and brothers who were working whole time for the cause of this institution. Lot of work to do. But this one sentence which touched my center of sympathy, yes, it is for a noble cause. Baba is asking me to help him. Actually, he is helping me. But it is a way of saying, would you not help me? And he wrote in Hindi, is boode Baba ko madad nahi karenge? Wouldn't you help this old man? This old father, you see. So that image I could never forget. Every time the thought will be, Bude Baba ko madad nahi karenge. 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 You see. Wouldn't you help this old father? You see. Wouldn't you help this old father? I could not sleep. I would wake up. Wouldn't you help this old father? You see. Yes, Baba, certainly I would help this old father. Just this one sentence brought me to this. Because I had a tendency to serve others. My life is not for me only. I should not be selfish. I should do something good. I should feel concerned for others. And he touched, Baba knows everyone, he touched my this center. And all that energy came up to help. And then Baba says, you are my hands and my arms. My hands and my arms. Now if as hands and arms we are not efficient, not worthy, not good, then what is our worth? What are we? What for? This again is touching our that center of sympathy. That you have to help me. Arms are for helping, for aiding. And for that purpose, we have again are roused to help in this task. Then Baba again says, he gives us a title. You are Dani and Mahadani and Vardani. You give gifts, you bless others. And this again therefore touches our that center of sympathy. So one I said is love. The other, which is the center, by touching which, by rousing which, like they say, there are chakras in Kundalini. you know, this center, that center, you have to awaken these centers. Perhaps some of you might be knowing what they say. Those who are after awakening Kundalini, they say there are many psychic centers, many plexus. You have to awaken them. And ultimately your Brahmarandra, your highest, your top is awakened. So that you get so many spiritual powers. Actually, these are the chakras. I gave you one chakra, the other chakra. They tell of 8 chakras, I am telling you of 16 chakras. Your Kundalini will awaken much more than what their Kundalini is awakening. So another one is self-respect. Self-respect. No one can be transformed unless or until his self-respect is roused. It is awakened. It brings a lot of change in a person very quickly, very easily. If you just awaken in him the sense of self-respect. Because people have lost confidence in themselves. They think they are worth nothing, fit for nothing. They have no value because they don't realize, recognize themselves. Many people saying that since the fall of Adam, we have inherited that sin. We are all sinners. There is so much of load of sins on our head. So, with that kind of a feeling of guilt, of shame, they think we are fallen beings. So, then what do you mean to say? That we have to go on falling further? Or who will awaken us? But Baba awakens, his way of transforming is very different. It's not that you just go to the church and confess, "My Lord, you see, I am a fallen being." Not this kind of confession, you see. Just prostrate yourself on the ground and with a shakiness in your throat, you just begin to confess. That is not enough. You must change where your self-respect. If really you are ashamed of what you have done, then get up. Do something great and good. As was the morning song, "Be good. Bano mahan karo kalyan." Be good. Do something good. Great. You can do it. You have that potential. You are the children of the divine. Why don't you realize this? This is the first thing you must realize. Otherwise, just by confessing every time and again, "I am a fallen being in so many ways," by music, by playing the guitar and so on and so forth. You see, as we have all this paraphernalia of worship, it is not leading us any further. We are where we are stuck up. Where we are. So, self-respect. And Brahma says, Baba says, you are Brahmins, the topmost class. Those who are mouth-born children of Brahma, brain children of Brahma, created by Shiv Baba, the highest. Who is your seed? What cannot you do? You are Master Almighty. Recognize yourself. As Vivekananda said, "Arise, awake." So you have to arise, awake. But he simply said, "Arise, awake." How to arise? How to awake? How can we become awake? Because when we realize who we are. So therefore, Baba first of all touches this center of self-respect. Everyone in fact has self-respect. I have not seen even the meanest of the mean who does not have a little bit of self-respect. He would only be a dead corpse who does not have self-respect. Because there is at least an iota of self-respect in every human being. Because all of us are after all descended not from apes, but from God. And since we have descended from God, therefore self-respect is there. The only thing is it is to be awakened. I have seen so many laborers who are paid only a pittance. When you talk to them in a rough language, they say, "Babuji, dear sir, I have sold my time, not my self-respect. Here is the work I don't want to do. Pay me or don't pay me, I am going away. After all, when I come to you for work, because you are paying me, I have sold my time, my energy. For 8 hours you have to pay me this much. But I have not sold my self-respect, mind you." I have seen even such people who wearing very dirty, shabby clothes, and charging very little for their hard labor and talking these words. Even any person, any beggar also. If you just address a beggar in a different way, he says, "Babuji, bolo to theek tarah se. Dear sir, if you don't give me any coin, at least speak nicely." You see, even he says that. "You may not put anything in my bowl, I don't mind it. but don't hurt me. What do you mean by hurting? There is a center of self-respect. I have an individual dignity. That is my human right, the first human right, which is now being recognized by all the people in the world. Every individual is a dignified human being. You must treat him like that. It is not like a carrot or a brinjal you are treating. It is a human being. Where is the human dignity? Why? Because all are descended from God. They don't know why, where from comes the human dignity. So that self-respect is there. It is to be awakened. And Baba says it in so many words. And one of the ways Baba says is, you are Brahmins, the highest. You are mouthborn. The Brahmin is very, very different from a Shudra. People are talking about the caste system in altogether a body conscious way. They say he is a low born, therefore Shudra. Anyone who is born to a scavenger, for example, they think he is a Shudra. Baba says no, that is not the way, that is not the basis of classification. Anyone who is the meanest, who does sins, whose thinking is negative, who is the vilest, who is totally in the grip of the evil, he is Shudra. But you are the high born. Brahmin is called high born because Shiv Baba is the highest and Brahma Baba is the next. So you are born through the mouth of Brahma. Shiv Baba gave you the birth. Therefore you are Brahmins. It is not like Brahmins to do like this. You should act like a Brahmin. So when you recognize you are this identity, you have a self-respect. What should be my actions like? You are going in a train, you are working in some office, you are meeting some people, talking to them. You are aware. You belong to someone who is the highest. How should your speech be? What should your words be? How should you address people? When an ambassador meets another ambassador, he says, Your Excellency. He speaks like that. When someone meets a king, he says, Your Highness, Your Majesty. So our way of speech should be royal because we belong to the highest, the noblest that can be ever. So that gives us that kind of a feeling of self-respect, who we are. Baba says, you are my ambassadors, you are my messengers, you are the would-be princes and princesses. How should your behavior be? On the other hand, we previously did not know this. We thought we are ordinary people. We are nowhere. We are not worthy of being counted because our views, our opinion, our action doesn't matter. It has no value. You see, we have only the subsistence value. We have only the existence value. We exist simply. That's all. And Baba says, anyone who is royal, you are royal. Purity is royalty. Since you are pure, you are royal. Since you are royal, you should be pure. He takes it both ways. And a royal person, suppose a prince is going along the road for a morning walk. Something is lying on the road. It's shining like a piece of gold. Will it pick it up? No. He is royal. He has treasures full of gold. He is supposed to be not looking for these bits and pieces. His mind should be above all these things. So should your mind be, because you are royal. A Brahmin does not touch anything which is lying on the dirty ground, however precious it may be, because after that he becomes spoiled, he becomes polluted. Thus goes the tradition, thus goes the saying, the belief. So you cannot allow the negative thoughts, the bad thoughts to enter your mind and to touch you. They say Brahman believed in untouchability. That Shudra cannot touch a Brahmin. Now Baba says this kind of untouchability, that a bad thought cannot touch your soul. A bad thought is the Shudra. You as a soul are the Brahmin. Your bad thought should not, your bad sanskara should not touch, your bad habit should not touch yourself, your soul, which is now Brahmin because you are reborn. You have taken a new birth. And you are twice born, as they say. A Brahmin is said to be twice born. One, you had physical birth, now you have the spiritual birth. You are twice born. And after becoming twice born, you should be in your proper shine, proper shape. proper purity, proper format, and you must not allow any bad evil thought to touch your soul. That is what is meant by saying that the Shudra should not touch the Brahmin. If Brahmin is touched by a Shudra, it is said even if the shadow fell on a Brahmin, Brahmin would go and take showers, take bath, change his clothes. Now this is what is meant here is that if any negative thought has touched your mind, read some Murli, try to purify yourself, sit in meditation. This is the shower, this is the bath which we should take to purify, to cleanse ourselves again and to be purified again. But people have interpreted everything, all these things in gross terms. Then in another way, Baba says, you are a lion. You are a lion. You should not behave like a lamb. Because when some people are afraid of doing something, of saying something in straightforward ways, Baba says, oh, why are you afraid? You are a lion. You are as Shaktis riding on a lioness or a lion. Shiv Shakti. You are Shiv Shakti. And Durga and Kali and all these are shown by the artists or the sculptors to be riding on the back of a lion to symbolize, to connote this fact that they have the courage, the boldness, the power, the spirituality, that kind of valor in them. So that is what you are supposed to have. Why you behave like dumb driven cattle? Some of them saying, I want to come to the class daily, but my husband does not allow me. I want to come to the class daily, but my father does not permit me. I saw a lady who just bolted the door from outside for her husband. The husband could not come out. I thought that the wife is the husband and the husband is the wife. You see, actually opposite of it. What does husband mean when you say it is animal husbandry, for example? What does husband mean? Actually, in this male-dominated world, a husband was supposed to dominate the female. In our country, when Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister, there was a saying that Indira Gandhi is the only male in the cabinet, you see. All others are the females, because she behaved like that, you see. So I am not talking from that background. What I am saying is that we should have the self-respect. After all, what we decide, what we understand, what we value, who can prevent us from this? Whether it be a vagary of nature, or it may be any obstacle put by any human being, or by any of our own inner thoughts, nothing can stand in our way. We must go to the class. No one can hold us back from getting that treasure of gems which we find in Murli daily. Similarly, in other efforts, whatever effort we want to do, some people would say, we want to give up the non-vegetarian food, we want to give up drinking of alcohol, but what can we do? Our family, in our family, the wife prepares the non-vegetarian food, so we have to eat, you see. So are you a drum-driven cattle? Somebody just thrust down your throat while you open your mouth. If you don't have that much of power to eat whatever you like to eat, why you are living after all? I can't understand. You are living under somebody like a donkey is ridden by somebody, you see. Someone is riding on the back of the donkey. If that is my kind of life, I would like to die rather than live a donkey life, you see. Live like a lion if you want to live. Otherwise, don't be a donkey, you see. Some people say we should have tolerance, but donkey has a lot of tolerance, I suppose. Not this kind of tolerance, which is of a donkey. We should have tolerance. Tolerance is a virtue. But not the tolerance of a donkey. You may kick a donkey, you may whip a donkey, but it moves on. It obeys you. That kind of donkey-like tolerance is not the tolerance. It's not a virtue. It is a vice, I suppose. It is a seventh vice. Six vices we already know. This is the seventh. Then, in order to rouse our self-respect, Baba says, you are the ones who are being worshipped in temples. This Lakshmi and Narayana, this Rama, these Shaktis. It is actually you. It is your past which is being worshipped. You are so great, you don't realize who you are in this ordinary body because this is the last of your life. But this was your Adi Swaroop, your beginning. You once upon a time were like this, gods and goddesses, which are being worshipped in temples. In the names of the deities, People are getting something, they are having their livelihood. To them, they feel peace even in temples. So if you are not peaceful, you say, Baba, my mind is not stabilized. Again and again, I lose peace of my mind. So people go and try to get peace from your idols, from your images in the temples. And you who are a living deity, a living god or goddess, you say, I am peaceless. What to say about this? It should not happen. Then another thing Baba says, you are very well known but unknown warriors. Unknown but very well known warriors. Just know yourself. Because you are unknown, because outwardly you have no weapons. You are not wearing any warrior-like dress. No guns you have. Not in a military jacket. But with medals and all those things, as a military person, Navy, Air Force, Army, different kind of costumes they have, the dresses. So people do not know that you are a non-violent soldier of the highest kind of army, which is going to be victorious. But you are mentioned in all the scriptures as Shaktis who killed the devils, as Pandavas who defeated the Kauravas. There are no other warriors which have been mentioned in the scriptures. You have been mentioned in all the scriptures and you are that. So you can change your sanskaras, transform your habits. You can win a victory over the evil because you did it before. And there is a mention everywhere that you achieved this before. You are therefore unknown and very well known warriors. If you talk to somebody and say, Major General Sir, now he thinks, Major. When you say Major General Sir, he stands alert because that moves his spirit. Yes, I'm an army man. Whenever an army man speaks, he says, I am a disciplined person because I'm an army man. He has that awareness of having been a retired general in the army. So how he is supposed to behave? So what we are, as army under the command of Shiv Baba, who is our commander, what are we supposed to do? To defeat the forces at their ground, the forces of negativity, the forces of evil, provided we recognize. And sometimes Baba compares Brahmins to top knot, the highest. That is your real, I don't have, you don't see here. I only touched here. I did not mean to show you that I have a top knot. Sometimes some hair are loose from here in my, because you know they are not stuck up at their proper places. And some people I hear mentioning saying Jagdish Bhai still has a top knot. Not that, you see. But Brahmin class is top knot. Baba says you are top knot. Then again he says you are my really special children. Aap mere vishesh bachche. My special children. It's a great tribute which Baba pays to us. Shiv Baba, who recognizes, if he, the highest, speaks these words to us, for us, you are my special children. Baba cannot be untrue. Baba does not just say something which is just to please us without any meaning, in a non-serious way, in a joking way. Not that. When Baba says you are my special children, let me realize my speciality. I am very, very special. And very often he says, out of tens of millions, I selected you. Out of tens of millions. That way you are special. So my acts, my speech, my thought, my habits, my sanskaras should therefore be special. By saying this, what he means to say is to awaken my self-respect. In some of the Murlis he says, I see you double crowned. I can see your future very clearly. You are my double crowned, double sovereign children. Now, Baba says, he is who knows the future. He is Trikal Darshi. I may not be able to see because my insight, foresight is not that much developed. But Baba knows everything. The past, the present and the future is very clear to him. And he says you are double crowned. Then as a double crowned child of Baba, how should my manners, my etiquette, my behavior, my thought, my speech, my lifestyle, my way of living be? Double crowned. He also says, you are angels. Angels. Very often when we used to read the fairy tales or the angel tales, we thought that we are human beings in flesh and bones, and there are another kind of a species, another kind of beings, another kind of life who can fly. But when Baba says you are the angels, so should we be, our lifestyle be like angels. Our speech, our actions should be according to that. And sometimes in some mudlis, Baba says, know your position. Set yourself in your seat. Know your position. And all opposition will end. He just compares the position and opposition. The forces of nature opposing you, people opposing you, your own sanskaras opposing you. But all this opposition will cease the moment when you realize your position. And what is that position? I am a child of God. Who is the knowledge? Who is the ocean of knowledge, of peace, of bliss, of love? Who is Almighty? That is my position. Let me position myself, and the opposition from the sanskaras will cease. All hostility, all resistance from the sanskaras would immediately stop. That is the way of transforming ourselves. So self-respect is another factor. Then another center which Baba touches through his murlis is Vairagya, dispassion, Vairagya. Sometimes in the murlis, it is English translation, it is translated as disinterestedness. But I would say not disinterestedness, we are interested in the world. It's not that we are disinterested in this world. But we have dispassion, which is what Baba says is Vairagya. Now, when we have Vairagya, Baba says, then you will have Tyag. Vairagya, that dispassion, not feeling so much attracted by worldly things. You are not moved, not tempted, not allured, not attracted, not pulled by the worldly things. Things and persons. That is what Vairagya is. And this Vairagya automatically leads you to Tyag. Baba says unlimited Vairagya. Behad ka Vairagya. Not Vairagya in a limited sense. Not that you feel disinterested or you have dispassion for only certain people, but for the whole world. You are not attracted. It no longer fascinates you. It no longer charms your mind. You are no longer pulled by the worldly objects. Your senses are not attracted by the worldly objects. That kind of Vairagya. He therefore wants to awaken that feeling of Vairagya in us. Now how he does that? One of the ways of doing this is, Baba says, it is whatever is there in this iron age world, it is moth-eaten. It is moth-eaten, it is rotten, it is rusty. It is degenerate. Why you are after this? So, if there is wheat, there is barley, there is rice, there is anything which is moth-eaten, eaten by the worms, it is not fit for eating, not fit for consumption. If you have a furniture which is eaten by the worms, by the termites or whatsoever, the insects which eat them, then you throw them away. It is no use. It is bad. Baba says all this world, iron aged world, is now in that condition, that degenerate condition, moth eaten, rusty, rubbish, wastage. So you as royal being should not feel attracted towards it. Just compare it to golden age. How were the things there? And this what attracts you is really only a kind of an illusion or delusion. You do not know what is under it. As if somebody puts the rubbish, the garbage, in a beautiful looking plastic bag. The outward bag is very attractive, very good. But when you open it, you find it's bad, rubbish, garbage inside. So what do you feel? You feel not attracted, you feel some kind of abhorrence for it. So does Baba say, this is the present fate, the present state of the world. So you must have Vairagya. The human beings, for example, for whom you have attraction, or the moha, as Baba says, attachment. There is not a single person who is completely healthy. Not a single person who never had any kind of a hurt or who does not have any kind of a sign of suffering on the skin, on the body, here, there, or anywhere. No one is full in the sense we have the gods and goddesses whom disease never touches, sorrow never touches. Sorrow is one of the mental disease, and no one's face is completely happy. There are some curves on the face. The artists know it better when they want to show that this person is sad or has sorrow or is displeased or is depressed. They show various kinds of curves. Every human being has one or the other kind of a curve to show that if not today, then sometime in the past, this person has passed through trauma. Either fear or sorrow or depression or tension. Our faces have not that beauty, that original beauty, the beauty of a person who never had these kind of negative feelings. That original healthy body cannot be there. For one reason, because it is born out of sex lust. For the other, that our parents also, we inherited the genetic genes from them, and they also were suffering. And therefore, in our life, we also, because of our negative actions, have been suffering. And this body and mind, they interact. So how can there be any healthy persons? And with the mental negativity in all of them, all the human beings, if we are attracted to them, they are the moth-eaten, the rusty, the garbage, the rubbish. And only the outward appearance is like that. All that glitters is not gold. We must keep in our mind. So Baba says, you must have vairagya for all this. For all this. Behad ka vairagya. Unlimited. Not this, that, or the other thing, but all this. Another thing Baba says is whatever is visible will be ultimately destroyed. It's going to be destroyed. So something when you are seeing it is going to be destroyed, it is going to slip out of your hand anyway. Whatever you are having is not going to last for your coming generations or for yourself for much longer. And very soon it will lose its value. As you find the rupee is losing its value, the ruble is losing its value. And very soon you will find the economic conditions of the powerful, the mighty countries. The economic condition you would find, like in America, the dollar, the pound, the yen, all will be devalued. A time is coming because our economic system is such, each one is dependent upon the other. As long as they are importing the raw material from the third world countries, all their industries are working full time, maybe overtime, because they get those things. And when these third world countries get the technological know-how and the means to produce goods, why should they give them the raw material when they can have it in their own? Why not sell the finished goods themselves, you see? So they are all dependent. And a day is going to come when all the economy everywhere is going to fail. Your rupee will not be worth anything. Now the rupee in India, as compared to its base value in 60s, is only 8 or 9 paisas, you see, 1/13. And the inflation is so much, every year a chunk of your rupee is finished. 15%, 16%, 80%, 18% inflation. And in some countries, 100% inflation. The coin is losing its luster, its value. Similarly, the human beings having so many modern diseases, person is looking very beautiful, but you do not know that he has a stomach ulcer inside. Outwardly, the face is shining, very brilliant. The figure is majestic. But underneath it is a disease. Some cancerous growth has taken place. Everyone is diseased. Only our eyes, because they are not microscopic sight, we cannot see. Our eyes are not working like the scanning machines or sonographic machines or like X-rays. Therefore, we do not know because of our ignorance. But why should we have attraction for these? Therefore, Baba says, you must have dispassion, vairagya, Then another thing is, Baba says, you are already under the burden of your karmic account. And you have bondages. So many bondages. Bondages of gurus, bondages of scriptures. So many bondages he has given a big list of it. But by just getting attached to them, feeling a pull towards them, feeling an attraction towards them, feeling fascinated, charmed with them, you are further developing your bondages if you don't have vairag. Therefore, you must have vairag. So he touches this center and tries to arouse our this feeling of detachment, getting detached from them. And once this vairag is there, after vairag is tyag, you give up the evils. You give up the attachment. And when you become nashto moha, your attachment is gone, then the basis of all the evils is gone. Then the transformation takes place at full speed. Sometimes Baba says, ye to kabar dakhil hai. They are as good as dead. Their legs are in grave. Perhaps they are 3/4 in grave. But the English proverb says his legs are in grave. An old man, they say his legs are in grave. But now so far as this world is concerned, I think up to here it is in grave. Only the face is outside. That's all. So you love a dead person. You are kissing a dead person, a corpse. You are trying to have this. In some of the Murlis, Baba says, Tyag se bhagya banta hai. If you just have vairagya, you have tyag. That is renunciation, the spirit of giving up. When you have that spirit of renunciation, that is tyag, that is what makes your fortune. It is not that you lose anything, but on the other hand, you gain so much. Some people think by doing tyag, we lose everything. Actually, it is not that. When you do the tyag, you have the spirit. Not that sthul tyag, not that grass form of renunciation. That the object is very much in your mind. Only outwardly you have renounced it. Not that kind of renunciation. Mental renunciation. You have no attachment, no attraction for the thing. You no longer feel charmed by it. That kind of attitude of renunciation is a real renunciation. You are not pulled by it. It is not working like a noose in your neck or your nose. You are not being pulled by it. So when that kind of renunciation is there, you are really building your fortune. Christ, for example, did some tyag. So many churches have been built up in his memory. People cover them with the gold plates. You know, they offer their so much money to these places. Similarly in temples, similarly to the holy people. Why they do it? Because they did tyag. So when you do tyag, you will have bhagya. Bhagya means good fortune, luck. Then Baba says, it is like an insurance. When you give the premium, then your risk is covered. Then you are paid afterwards manifold, many number of times. So when you just do tyag, then you are ensuring, when you put something in bank, you get always the interest, compound interest or simple interest. Similarly, when you just do this renunciation, this tyag, when you use this for the well-being, for the benefit of others, it is not that you are losing something, it is a wastage on your part. On the other hand, you are ensuring it for your next lives, number of lives. And Baba's beautiful phrase, very beautiful phrase. Baba says, giving is having. It seems to be a paradox. Giving is having. This three-word phrase, giving is having. This golden age civilization is based on this formula. Giving is having. Everyone wants to give. One feels happy in giving. In the present civilization, people feel happy in grabbing, in having. In greed, they feel happy, fulfilled. And in the golden age civilization, and in the Sangam Yogi civilization, which is the foundation for the golden age, giving is having. You give. Everyone wants to give out of love. When Baba explained how, what kind of economy or marketing system we will have in golden age, Baba said people will not sell things there. Nowadays people are talking of market friendly or market economy, open markets, privatization, this kind of thing, this kind of economic system. But in golden age, suppose I had wheat from my farms. So in my shop there is wheat. Now this person had cloth from the cotton because he has got some weaving machines. So that cloth is prepared. So in his shop there is store of wheat. Another person, he had gold ornaments, so on. This person comes to my shop, takes as much wheat as he likes. It is not that there is barter system in exactly according to that amount he has to pay me in kind, if not in cash. Take it, because the world is a family. From the family member you don't say put something in my pocket because it is so many rupees, so many paisas, you know. Take it. I go to the other, I take cloth. The other one goes to the gold shop, takes the gold. Because we are not greedy, we want as much as we want. So everyone is giving and feeling happy in giving. And in giving, he is also having. So giving is having. That is the basis of the new civilization, new society, new culture. When you have that spirit, then only you can give up greed, lust for things, exploitation, injustice. So many kinds of negativity you can finish at one stroke. If you believe in this, giving is having. Then again Baba says, De daan to chute grahan. If you just give something in charity, because in people have been saying it in so many ways. You know, when the sun or the moon, there is what they call, what you call grahan? Eclipse. When any one of them is eclipsed, the Brahmins or other people come to houses and they say, Mataji, because Mataji has a soft mind rather than Pitaji. The mothers, the ladies are soft minded, therefore he addresses Mataji, oh dear mother. He does not say dear father or brother because they are a little hard to tackle. Some people worship Radhe, not Krishna. So someone, whenever you would talk to him, he would say, Radhe, Radhe. I would say, I have come to invite you on behalf of the institution. He would say, Radhe, Radhe. It means, okay, yes, fine. Then I would say, our institution is known as Brahma Kumari's World Spiritual University. Radhe, Radhe, he would say. Okay, okay, go ahead. Then I would say, in our institution, these kinds of teachings are imparted. Radhe, Radhe, he would say. Now, why you worship Radhe? Why not Krishna? You see, he says Radhe is after all a lady. I can tackle her easier, you know. And if she is pleased, she can get something from Krishna for me. In order to approach Krishna, like you approach the private secretary of a boss, you know. So it was a good reply, he said. I liked it. He said, sometimes you go to the mother to get something from the father, you know. Father is not paying you the money. He says, you are wasting money, I don't want to give you. You don't know how to earn. I have to do so much work and then I earn money. You are frittering it away. He goes to the mother and begins to weep. The mother goes and puts, you see, hand in the pocket of the father and gives it to the child very easily. So therefore, this person had that strategy of getting something from God, not from Krishna directly, but via or through Radhe, you see. So when I was saying it is eclipsed, what they think is that if you give something, then that eclipse will be over. It will not eclipse. The eclipse will not have any kind of a effect on you. Therefore, Baba says, De daan to chute grahan. This is how it will finish. That is another way of getting things. And Baba says, when you donate, when you give this sex, lust, anger, greed, attachment, then the eclipse of the soul will be finished, will be over, and your soul will have its original shine. And this giving or renouncing or tyag, Baba also says in another beautiful word, namely surrender. Unless or until you surrender yourself, before we come to this knowledge, before we surrender ourselves to Baba, We have laid down all our arms and weapons before Maya. We have surrendered to Maya. Because we are working according to the dictates and commands of Maya. But this is the first sign of transformation when mentally, this is really the transformation and the, what you can say, the mental renunciation in the form of surrender. Those who believe that the self is God, they have not this method open to them of self-transformation. Those who are monists by philosophy, by thought, Aham Brahmasmi, I am God, Shivoham, I am Shiva. To whom then you will surrender? If you are God, will you surrender to yourself? If you are Brahm or the ultimate or the supreme, to whom you will surrender? And unless or until you surrender, you cannot be free from anxiety and worry and negativity. There must be someone to whom you must be open to correction. Someone before whom you say, I surrender my intellect to you. Tell me, what am I to do? Read the whole of the Gita and read the final versions, final verses. Arjuna at that point of time, after putting so many questions, he says, my Lord, now all my doubts have gone. All my questions have been solved. My attachment is finished. He says, Nashto Moha. Smriti Labda. Now I realize, I remember who I am. And Gat Sandeha. All my doubts have been finished. Then he says, Karishyase Vachanam Tav. Now I will do as you bid. I surrender myself to you. This is the fruit of knowledge. This shows your ripening stage. This really shows that you have understood who is teaching you. Unless surrender, you surrender yourself to him. They say there are two ways of surrender. They generally give the example of the young one of a cat and also the young one of a monkey. The young one of a monkey, what it does, it is like this. It hangs underneath the belly of the mother monkey, the young one. But it has to do this much of effort of holding on to the body of the mother. So when that monkey jumps from one branch to the other branch, if that loses the grip of the mother, would fall on the ground and would die. So it has surrendered to the mother, is depending upon the mother. But this surrender has one thing, namely that it has to stick on to. This little bit effort it has to do. But in the case of the cat, the kitten, the young one of a cat, the cat is carrying the kitten into the mouth from one place to the other. The kitten does not hold the cat around its belly. It has not even to do that effort. It completely surrenders to the cat, to the mother. Lift me anywhere you like, in any way you like. The cat, between the two jaws, takes that kitten and takes it wherever it likes. It may jump from one place to the other, from one house to the other, one house top to the other house top, or from one place to the other. The kitten does not mind it, whatever the mother does. It is completely surrendered. This is the real surrender. That Baba jahan bithaye, wahan baithu. Jahan uthaye, wahan uthu. Jo kahe, wo karu. Wherever you ask me to sit, I sit. Whatever you ask me to do, I do. Whatever you ask me to obey, I certainly obey. This kind of a spirit of total surrender, not surrender. Add this adjective, this qualifying word, total surrender. Many of us have surrendered, no doubt. But the surrender is not yet total. We have not shown the white flag. We have surrendered, but the guns are still with us. Before the opposite army completely surrenders, totally surrenders, it shows the white flag. No more fighting. Okay. Surrender. They put their hands up. Surrender. So the enemy thinks, all right, now it is surrendered. They take charge of them. But still the gun is lying. The pistol is hanging. So the complete surrender will be when that pistol, that gun, that uniform, that is surrendered. Total cartridges, that gunshots, everything is surrendered. Similarly, if we have surrendered, but not total surrendered, we have kept something with us, then it's not complete surrender. Like that kitten, that young one of a cat. That kind of surrender should be there. Then it is complete surrender. Now, I have dealt with only four. But as I said, there are 16, you see. And it's already going to be, so I think I stop here. Maybe next time I take the rest. We sit in meditation for some time. Thank you. Om Shanti.